All right, here we go. The great thing about working out, spiritually working out, is you get to the next phase, and you see results, and that's what's happening now. Welcome here to this wow video, where we practice full stop on the wow as our practice, giving the benefit of the doubt to the Dharma Kings, that they have our back, they're helping us, which means our progress is super fast, super great, and therefore, because our progress is so fast, we have to practice full stop on the wow every day. Otherwise, it's going to be trouble, it's backlash. So every day, I try to practice this, giving them the benefit of the doubt that they're actually moving us forward very fast. The alternative is to not practice it, which means not give them the benefit of the doubt, which means give what? The ego the benefit of the doubt, that we're not being helped. You see this? Why practice is really required, because if the Dharma Kings are helping us out, then that means we better be practicing just to keep up. The progress, and the fact is, the progress is so stupendous right now for me. There's no doubt that I'm in the wow. Tremendous, just tremendous progress is taking place. I promised them that I would do these darshan videos. I got it done. I did 4 in 3 days. Saturday I did one on Sunday, and then 2 on Monday. I said, I promise you, I'll get it done. So I have one for each Jamyang Khyentse Choki Lodro, Rama Harshi, Anandamayi Ma, and Longchenpa. Have these darshan videos now that help us keep up here from all different angles. So the progress that I've had as far as insights go is staggering. So I have to be very disciplined, full stop in the wow. Neither accepting nor declining. Just allowing it to be, having confidence. And as Ramana Maharshi says, trust it. In other words, trust the grace of God. Trust it. And so put in the time to sit quietly like this, which is the highest practice, with faith that in the willingness to dissipate the shock of success, that the success will arrive, and it does arrive. I can tell you this for sure. Now, the only one who can measure our quote unquote coolness, if you want to talk about coolness, and this is what, the second day of summer, and it's blazing hot here in California. If you're in the Southland, yesterday was just, I guess, some records in the Southwest. It was just vicious heat. We got some heat up here. It was supposed to be 88. Guess how hot it was? 98. I mean, it's cooking in California. And this week and next week is supposed to be really hot. So summer, the long hot summer has got off with just a bang. You know, just, wow. So our path has also gotten off to a real bang. And we're talking about coolness. Like today, someone said something that was just triggered this immensely important insight. I had this dream last night where I realized I've been trapped my whole life by trying to be cool to someone else's measurement. What's cool? Well, you know, are you good? Are you valuable? Are you cool? I was using someone else's measuring stick for that my whole life, and I saw it very clearly in the dream. I said, wow, what do I do about this? I don't know, but I said, I'm just going to wow it and just stick with it. I'm not going to struggle for answers. It will come, trust it. Well, someone made this chance comment to me. It was amazing what happened. And I was talking about this cooling rag. I said, you need a cooling rag? He says, hey, look, I'm always cool. I'm just a cool person, I don't need it. I'm always, and suddenly a trigger said, wait a minute. Who determines what's cool? Who's the arbiter of what's a cool person? And suddenly I realized, you know what? It's the gurus, the Dharma Kings that are the only judges of what's cool. And In the dream I had seen, I was double teamed by men and women. There's this game they play for their own advantage of enslaving you to working for what they claim is cool, which is their own creature comforts and supporting their laziness, a lifestyle of laziness. And that's what I've done my whole life, supported this. And I see, oh, they're not the arbitrators of what's cool. Women don't have a clue of what is cool from a sticking from a man's standpoint. And from a woman's standpoint, you'd say men don't have a clue what is really cool also, okay? Absolutely. However, the reason why we say women are emphasized, I would emphasize it, is because we assume that we think that they made us. They created, you know, they created our body, our identity. We think they created our being. They gave life to us. So they must know what is right, what is cool, what is the right life. We assume mother knows best. This is absolutely not true. What we are, spirit, we're never born. Ramana said, moksha is realizing you've never been born and you can never be born. It's impossible. That's true liberation, and nothing other than that is liberation. So women did not make us, okay? They made the body, which is simply a sensory perception apparatus designed to blind us to spiritual reality. So how could the makers that would make sensory perception apparatus, how can they possibly know what's cool? It's ridiculous. And yet we assume, the world assumes, the world is a bunch of mother worshippers, actually. That everybody's following what they think, their mothers, their wives, their girlfriends, their, you know, some women, what they think is cool. Like, okay, this is what's cool. I gotta be that way. And then the men also play into this whole thing, too. And I said, hey, wait a minute. I said, wow. That's the answer. He said, I'll let the guru decide whether I'm cool or not. Thank you very much. I'll use their yardstick, their measuring stick. They'll be the measure of whether I'm cool or not. Not anybody in this world. No. So I said, I'm not going to let anybody in this world judge me anymore, what's cool and what's not. But I realized during the day I was overcompensating, trying to appear to be cool to people, because this issue is like really rising up now. Rising with the heat here. Yesterday I had an amazing, I was going to do a lineage tree, homage to our lineage masters, the Dharma kings, Jesus Christ, Longchenpa, Ramana Maharshi, Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro, Sri Sri Ananda Maima, and the auxiliary St. Paul and St. Jude, and Chandra Tsering Chodron. We have these various Sri Bolanath, Brahma Maharshi, Punjaji, for instance, and Muji. I include Muji here. I include Muji because he gave me a big boost in my life when I really needed it. And he inspired these videos by what he was doing, and he comes from the Brahma Maharshi lineage tree of Punjaji and then Muji. So absolutely, those who help me like this, you know, I'm going to speak up and say, yeah, they did help. Absolutely, it did help. His humor, his heart, the way he goes about it, it was a big help for me in my life. I'm not putting him a Dharma king at all, but he's part of that lineage of the Dharma king Ram Maharshi. You see, he's part of that. So and just like Chandra Tsering Chodron is part of the lineage tree of really Longchenpa, and we say Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro also is a Dharma king, and he was her spiritual consort, and she's done miracles already. So these are the ones that are, you know, have been very helpful. Punjaji is very helpful. He kept the Dharma alive. He has a lot of transmissions, a lot of students that came from him that sort of helped spread Ram Maharshi's gospel. You know, so he's there too. And of course, all of this is the holy work of the Holy Spirit. And so I was going to Jesus, of course, with Saint Paul and Saint Jude have helped me out. A Course in Miracles and Journey Beyond Words. But you know who helped did that? William Thetford and of course Helen Schuckman, who transcribed in shorthand A Course in Miracles, along with Dr. Brent Haskell, who transcribed Journey Beyond Words, who heard it internally, heard it and taped it, and the other voice. These are essential, great, great helps in homage to our lineage tree, our overall transmission tree, you might call it, our Dharma tree. The Tibetans are big on these trees, the umbrella of those who have helped them. So we're Keith Dalman does this on his site, homage to lineage masters, and he talks about also those back lineage of those who helped culturally influence and help them along. So I would include in our back lineage, I would include Keith Dalman, absolutely, because you know he gave a big boost, helped he's helping clarify the heart of the apex approach, which is really important, super super important. He's a hippie Dharma bum, great translator, so he's part of our back lineage, absolutely. Yes, Beach Boys are part of our back lineage. There's various Krishnamurti, there's various aspects of our back lineage that we do homage to. So we thank all of these great influences that we have, that have our backs, that really have our backs. Now, amazing event happened yesterday. As I thought about this, I said, okay, I conceived it, and suddenly I'm in this parking lot. There's this lady, sort of this old lady, looks like an older Jewish lady. And she's walking across, and she's kind of looking at me like, what's, hey, I don't like you or something. It's kind of like intimidated. I'm like, what did I do? I don't know what I do. And so she gets in the car, this Mercedes next to me, real nice Mercedes. And I realized my car, I went too far, and it was over the front line. I was over into the next parking space, and there wasn't any cars, or it was kind of open there. But I said, ah, you know what? That's too far. So I'm gonna get in the car and bring it back. So I was waiting for her to back out, and she didn't back out for the longest time. I said, what's going on? Finally, I can't understand. I finally walked around to my front door, and then she started backing out. And then I saw she was having a hard time. She couldn't really tell, like our car's coming or something. And I said, okay, so I'm gonna help her out. So I looked and got there. Come out, like this. I was helping her back out. And then she rolled down the window. She says, it's so hard to back out these days. It's so tough. And she has a Wellesley license plate holder and then a Stanford shirt on. So she's come to ask where she's from, Monte Sereno. So she's very wealthy, comes from a lot of wealth, privilege and wealth and stuff. But we had a conversation. And I finally said, do you live here? She goes, no, I don't live there. No, I live here. She's kind of a little, I heard her vanity or something. Like I said, oh, you're too young for that then. I kind of tried to ease it over. I always have trouble talking with women because I always forget to, you gotta be careful of their vanity because they get quite upset if you suggest that they might be old or not, not up to snuff. They really are very defensive about it. I've always found that to be true. And I'm careless about vanity. I don't really care about vanity, people's vanity, actually. I want to cut to the root. Let's get to the root. Forget about vanity. But so I always tend to run afoul of women that way. I'm heedless of their vanity, and they let me know, like, hey, buddy, don't you dare suggest that I'm not some, a princess. But I started thinking, oh, she's must be from back east. She's a very intelligent, very articulate Jewish woman. A little older than me, but she's. I said, I wonder if she knows Helen Schuckman from back east. I bet she's Wellesley. I mean, this is high class. And then suddenly, I realized what the whole thing. I couldn't figure out what the whole thing was about. It was very odd. I realized this is something. What's important? What is the Holy Spirit telling me? And it's telling me, it was telling me very clearly, Helen Schuckman does not want to be included in our lineage tree. She disavowed her work with A Course in Miracles, basically. It for some reason it irritated her that people would try to be putting her on a pedestal and stuff. She didn't want to be put in a pedestal. She said, "Look, it's Jesus, not me." And people even tried to say that she wrote the book, and so she doesn't want to have anything. So I was told, it was the Holy Spirit letting me know, don't put her on our lineage tree, just put A Course in Miracles there. Don't put her there. She doesn't want to be there. Isn't that amazing? Because I just decided to put her there, and this when this whole incident happened. And I was almost asked the lady, do you know Helen Schuck? Did you know Helen Schuckman, back at Columbia University? Because she seemed like she might have been from New York, going to Wellesley, that's back in that area, and might have been a part of the intelligentsia, Jewish intelligentsia back then. Yeah, she might have known Helen Schuckman, but she got kind of like a little bit, like, let me know, hey, don't, I'm you go to, you went to park too far. In other words, excluding her is going too far. I parked too far, and she noticed it, and something was not right with her. And Helen Schuckman does not want to be, historically attached to it for some reason. I guess it was really a burden for her. But hopefully we can lighten that burden for her. Because it's bigger than A Course in Miracles, okay? The whole thing is bigger than that. And, you know, the people, the whole way that it happened for her, it's bigger than that. It's bigger than that. Ah, wow. Summertime, here comes the lemonade. And so, you know, I want to help her out with that. I want to help these people out of the Course in Miracles, who, see, we have this big umbrella, okay? Now, and we're getting help from all different angles, and we need to step up and acknowledge the help and be part of it. Is it really important to be part of it? And these people, you know, false humility saying, no. No, that the false humility is a sin. I mean, it's part of arrogance, actually. There's only one sin, and that's arrogance. And you're either arrogant or you're not. It's black and white. You can't be a little bit arrogant, actually. It's like saying, well, reality's a little bit fragmented. No, it's not. It's not fragmented at all. It's either, arrogance believes that reality's complex, and the truth is reality is one. There's no complexity to it, actually. So I'm not sure if I'm going to include her or not. Maybe not right at this point. It's her prerogative, you know. It's her prerogative if she doesn't want to be. But she did a fabulous job, you know. I mean, and so what kind of example is she setting that those who do fabulous jobs should not admit to it or something? You know, I don't know. Now, on those Dharma Darshan videos, Dharma King Darshan, I don't put my name. I did have my name. I said, no, I don't need my name. Why do I need my name? I don't need my name. It's public. I put it in the public domain. I don't need my name on it. That's not important. It's just so, I tend to not put my names on stuff. So I understand where she's coming from. But, you know, we'll see. We'll see. I think it's, you know, I say I'm a Dharma prince because this is someone who's repented and realized that you're either arrogant or you're not. It's black and white. And so repentant is to realize it's black and white. There's no wiggle room. This takes you away from the pharisaical attitude of self-righteousness. Is that I'm less arrogant than you or I'm better than you. No. The Christianity, we're all sinners. We're all total sinners. It's either, you know, there's no wiggle room. This is very important. The idea of Christianity is we're sinners means we're arrogant. That's the sin, spiritual pride. And you can't be a little bit arrogant. You're either arrogant or you're not. And so a repentant mind is one who realizes that, hey, until I get free of arrogance, I am arrogant, plain and simple. There's no wiggle room. Okay? It's called Christianity. It's called Jesus Christ teaching, Dharma King Jesus Christ. And it's a fabulous teaching, and it's very, very true. And he brought this to light. He says the ones that are furthest away are the ones that are self-righteous and thinking that they're making that they're making progress, and so I'm not so arrogant. I've got that under control, or I made a sacrifice for it. You know, oh yeah, I'm arrogant, but if I sacrifice something, if I give something to God, say, here, God, yeah, I want more than you have, but I'm going to give you some of what I have, and let's call it good. That's the heart of arrogance. That's arrogance, and all arrogance is the heart of arrogance. Either reality is one or it's not. There's nothing. No middle ground at all. To claim there's a middle ground is, again, just total arrogance. And so the repentant mind sees this, and then the repentant mind says, oh my gosh, I've really got to work at this then. Okay? Now, those who really do work at it, the Dharma Kings have perfect awareness of who's working on it. How cool are we? We're talking about drag races today, and I was studying last night. I came across this video of the late 50s and early 60s, which is really drag race culture in America, especially Southern California, but it was all over. Southern California was the heart of it. And, I sort of grew up in that era, and the Beach Boys, a lot of the Beach Boys songs are about cars, 409, Little Deuce Coupe, you know, Shut Down, Cherry Coupe. They did a whole album of car songs. I mean, A lot of their hits were these great car songs. Fun wasn't a drag race song, but it was about, you know, cars. I mean, cars were a big theme, like the Beach Boys music, because that was the culture. They were like tuning in and hip to the culture. At least the lyricists were, Roger Christian. Well, there's some other, Brian, was it Ulster? There's a number they had a number of collaborators who are car nuts, who helped write these songs, actually. And these songs were actually really hip songs with all the slang that was really used in the car culture, and they drag raced, and the automobile industry was making all these stock cars for the kids to drag race in. That's what sold. So you had the Dodge Dart, which on the outside was just this very prosaic looking car, but that was the 413, you know, two cool shorts, actually. We mean short cars, the racing cars standing side by side, you know. A fuel-injected Stingray and a 413. 413 was the engine, wedgie, super maxi wedge engine, 413 engine by Dodge in the Dodge Dart, actually. And I was talking with someone about that today, and he said, "Oh yeah, Dodge Dart had the push button shifting on the console." I said, "Oh my God, a friend of mine I used to get rides with them to go surfing over in Santa Cruz, because I didn't really have the car or the gas money. I was young, and he was older and had this car, and he drove it like a maniac. And every time, back then, Highway 17 did not have a guardrail in the middle, and you had accidents constantly. And he would just be going around those turns at 80 miles an hour like a maniac. I always thought I was going to die. It was horrible. And he just drove like a bat out of hell. I mean, it was unbelievable how fast that car was. And I said, "Oh my gosh, that's the push button." He said, "That's a Dodge Dart. He had a Dodge Dart, 413 Dodge, super stock Dodge Dart." I don't know if it's a super stock, but that thing was fast. And he just smoked every car on the road in that car. But from the exterior, it didn't look like much. So in that drag race culture, everybody's trying to be cooler than somebody else, right? Because look, buddy, you know. And my dad actually grew up in pre-war, World War II, in Southern California, hot rod culture, modifying Model Ts, the cars of the day. Little Deuce Coupe by the Beach Boys is about a 1932 Ford Coupe, which was the car John Dillinger used to, he hot rodded it, and it could outrun all the police. That you were able to hot rod that engine, and you could go, they said 140 in that thing. And so my dad actually did that. He modified the Model Ts into hot rods back in Southern California, and before the war. So this culture was about, it was such a, I mean, it goes on, the 409s is Chevy Impala, okay? "She's real fine, my 409, she's real fine, my 409, my 4, that's a Chevy Impala. Of course, the Stingray was a Corvette, fuel-injected 327 Corvette. So you had all these cars that came out, and then ultimately Dodge came out with the Roadrunner. You have Plymouth, you have Roadrunner, the Barracuda, the Roadrunner. Pontiac with the GTO, little GTO, running the Daytonas, I think, the little GTOs. So many car songs back then. Well, that was the culture. The kids would save them, and I saved my money, I saved my dimes, because I knew there'd be a time that I would buy a brand new 409. It was very cheap. The Chevy M409 is very cheap. I think it was under $3,000. It was amazing what you could buy there by then. The car companies were cranking them out. Had, wow, you know, minimalist interiors, but those things are built for drag racing for a quarter mile, and they would drag race literally at nighttime, whenever that, you know, the police weren't around, and it was kind of allowed, and they'd have these people, and the two guys, "Hey buddy, I think I can shut you down. I think my wheels are better than yours. Let's find out." And that's the challenge, and they would get down on one of these wide streets and just, I mean, I don't know how they powered through the lights or something. I don't know if they had people blocking the intersections. They must have. It's dangerous, you know, if they did it. But I guess they picked long strips where, you know, they could slow down before the intersections, I would hope. But it was kind of dangerous. It was a very macho thing, and everybody's into it. So, you know, it's like, this is how you prove, like, I'm smarter, I'm more passionate, because they all had to modify their own cars, and they're working on it in well, they had machine shops, you know, bored it out, you know, increased the stroke and bored, poured and relieved, stroked and bored, you know, all this stuff. They changed and modify the heads and the piston stroke and how far the valves would go and all sorts of stuff. And they'd say, "I'm better, smarter than you are, more passionate about it and more clever and got more guts and I can shut you down. Well, of course, the women love this. They would say, who's the guys that can shut the other guys down? And then they would say, wow, this guy is a better prospect than this one. Really. I said, I can see this guy's going to go places because look how he's able to get this car just humming and going so fast. You know, I know he's going to get my life and our money humming and going fast too. And so it was a very big status thing. And cars were just huge back then. And you were judged on your car. Very, very much so. Probably still somewhat the case. I don't know. But, you know, it's status. And so you were evaluated on this. And so I realized, whose valuation of you should you accept? And I realized today that only the gurus can evaluate you properly. Women cannot evaluate anyone properly at all. Not even at all. Not at all. Zero. Men too, they can't evaluate properly. So why should we accept the evaluation of the flesh of arrogance for our... How far we've gone towards getting ready to drop arrogance? How far have we gone in our willingness to drop arrogance? Who can evaluate that? Should arrogance be the evaluator of it? This is what we've done. We put arrogance in charge of evaluating our efforts to get free of arrogance. You know, how arrogant is that? that's just insane, isn't it? And so I said, I'm not going to drag race. So a Dharma prince is someone who's been evaluated by a Dharma king or Dharma kings. And I realized all Dharma kings, all five of them have evaluated me as a Dharma prince, meaning you're getting the job done. You have a repentant mind and you're practicing full stop in the wow and you have faith in us and you're on the path of repentance and you're apparently doing well. And so they've given me these kudos. This Dharma prince. Jesus doing it by inviting me to his dwelling place. You know, that's pretty tremendous invitation. He's not going to invite anyone to his dwelling place if you're not really cool with him. If he doesn't think, wow, you're really cool. You know that you've got it. You've seen through it. The arrogance. You've repented. And then, of course, Longchenpa, with everything that he's done and giving me the title of Dharma Prince, is you know directly saying in his evaluation I'm a Dharma Prince. That means I've really repented and really worked at it. And then Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro coming in the dream and embracing me was just crying and just he was so happy. This is a very powerful statement. And the miracles he's been doing for me. Okay, so he's, you know, in his eyes, you know, he treated me like a brother, you know. So that's an endorsement, right? A very strong endorsement. Ram Maharshi, in the dream I had, he came and told me, he says, look, you're going to succeed. I know it. I already see it. There's no doubt about it in my mind. He says, it's already done, and you're going to be extremely helpful. And so he treated me again like a colleague, you know. So that's a very strong endorsement from Ram Maharshi. And then, of course, Sri Sri Anandamayi Ma, by insisting that I put all the boys first and their endorsements first ahead of her, that's a very strong endorsement right there, isn't it? She's a different way. She says, no, do them first. Don't worry, you know, forget about me. You get with what they're doing, okay? I don't need that. I don't need, you know, you go, and that's meaning she knew that they would endorse me, and that in itself is her own endorsement. You see that? Very interesting how she works. And I've met with her many, many, many times, and she's treated me with just this great grace, you know, just showering me with grace. So I've gotten the evaluation from Dharma Kings because I've turned to them and said, look, you evaluate me. I don't want the evaluation part. You evaluate me, and I'm willing to accept your evaluation. And what it basically is well, you gotta then put more effort in. You know, you're not working hard enough at it. Is their evaluation? So, wow, okay. So I work more and more and more. If you say, you know, you want a video today, you know, Jamyang Kyentse Choki Lodro, okay. I said, I'll do a Dharma. He said, great, that's very helpful. Please do so. I did it. I promised him I'd do it. I did it. Then I realized I need to do one for each one of them. I said, I'll get it done. Then I realized, I'll do two today. I said, I'm gonna do both, and I'm going to get it done before I go to sleep. And I did it. You know, I just absolutely focused on it and said, I'm not going to get, you know, this is like my job. This is what Dharma Prince does. They say, can you do this for me? I say, it's a done deal. could this, they say, this will help out. Can you do this? What's it help out for? It help outs for, I love this background, by the way, the ambience here and everything is just like, wow. It's just beautiful. What a gorgeous, insanely gorgeous day today. And this background looks, seems so cool. And what it's helping out for is to help us with our mental agitation. I'm starting to meet people now who are very surprisingly clear and tuned in. And they just open up to me. And I should be like passing out a business card or something to them. Just say, look, why? Because mental agitation is going to come. What is the crisis that we're looking at here in the world? And it's the inability to sleep is the crisis. There's no worse crisis when you lose the ability to sleep. It's the worst. Because all other troubles multiply from this, and desperation multiplies, and vulnerability multiplies, because you start overthinking everything. And having been through that, I'm an expert on it, and I'm dedicated to helping out with this, because I know just how hideous it is. I really have dedicated my life to being an expert on the trouble of being of sleeplessness, and the troubles that arise from this, and what's causing it, and how can we, you know, back this off and help out with this. So they're telling me, do these darshan videos. This will help. It is very helpful. I've been helped so much by these great Dharma kings. God bless each and every one of them, and may we all praise their names forever. Because if not for them, I would never have made it. Never have made it. And again, Helen Schuckman, I can mention her, and William Thetford, who helped bring and help bring Course in Miracles. Without that, without Course in Miracles, I wouldn't have made it. So they are part, an essential part of the overall success of what's going on in the world, really. So I'll have a talk with Helen and say, hey, you know, we'll see, we'll see. The you know, Dharma princes are very, very important and helpful. We should not just shrink away and say, no, I'm not. I mean, I'm putting these darshan videos up, public domain, on my web, on this website, you know, so people can draw the association if they want. I'm not trying to hide, you know, that I'm doing this stuff. But I don't want excessive fixation, attention, because I can't evaluate people. See, Dharma princes is still not able to evaluate properly. Only the Dharma kings can evaluate. How accepting are we of dropping arrogance? Only the Dharma kings, only the Holy Spirit knows for sure, really. And the extension of the Holy Spirit, the Dharma kings, they're the only ones that really know. I cannot properly evaluate. So, you know, I can't, there's no reason for anyone to fixate on me. I think that's what Helen was saying. People are fixating on her. She didn't like it. But I think there are others now, Helen, that are, you know, moving the ball forward. And so, you know, the pressure's off of you to some extent, really. Picking up the ball here, and you know, putting the tension where it all belongs is on the Dharma kings here. We're putting the tension on because they're the ones that can really cool us down. And again, the way to really cool your mind down is practice full stop on the wow every day. It brings in the understanding you don't have to think about it. It's a done deal already. Just practice. I'm already there. Don't think about how is it that I'm already there. Just say, no, I am already there. That's what's important. Not why am I already there, how, or any of that. But I am already there. This is what the gurus tell us. Ram Maharshi is so clear about it. He's so fabulously clear. Again, facebook.com/ Ramana Maharshi. Ramana Maharshi. Ramana Maharshi. Go to this website and just hang out and read the comments. You can add some of your own like things. Every day, there's numerous posts there. It's just a fabulous site. You could say, Dharma Prince Clarity Ross sent me here if you want, or not. You see? But that's fine. But check it out. If you really want to get a boost, I mean, I really do it. I'm really doing it. I spend time every day with Ram Maharshi on my screensaver slideshow and then going to that website. I try to stay in touch with him because he is just an absolute jewel of the apex approach, the super apex approach. We're already there. I mean, this is all that he ever says. Every question they ask him, they say, "What?" He just turns it back on and says, "What? What do you mean? Who wants to know the answer to this question? I mean, you're already there. There's no questions. You're unquestionably the self." He always turns it around and doesn't play their game. I mean, he's truly extraordinary in his teaching capacity, and it is a tremendous blessing that we're able to focus and have his, pictures and nearness and time with Ram Maharshi. It is just tremendous. He has the knack to really help us wake up. And he said something yesterday I read that was super helpful. He said, if you even get the, he said, if you look at it this way and you even see it vaguely like this, he said, that's enough. And I said, my God, what he was talking about and expressing in his comment was exactly what I had seen yesterday. I saw exactly what he was saying very clearly. But now I was a little fuzzy about it because, the wow had come up. But he says, it's okay. All you need to do is see it vaguely, and that's enough. And I said, holy cow, what a brilliant, brilliant comment by him. It's just perfectly spot on because this is exactly what we struggle with, right? We see it, and then we start, the wow rises, and then it becomes sort of vague to us, So, and then he would say, trust it. You saw it, trust it, which is really full stop on the wow, is trust it. He's very good with these pithy statements, like just, trust it. And you just feel, boom, that's it. He's right. He is absolutely right. So do not put your faith in the evaluation of the world. The evaluation of the world is the evaluation of arrogance about how well you're doing towards dropping all arrogance. And of course, the goal of arrogance is that you never drop it. So how could you trust the evaluation from the flesh, from the world, from the sensory perception apparatus, which is really the frantic pursuit of spiritual blindness? How can you trust the frantic pursuit of spiritual blindness to evaluate how we doing as far as dropping this pursuit? Now, as a Dharma prison, one thing is you don't drag race anybody anymore. And it means you don't accept their evaluations of the world anymore about yourself. You turn the Dharma kings and says, you evaluate me. I'll accept your evaluation 100%. It's up to you how I'm doing. And think about a Dharma prince. You don't drag race a Dharma prince. It's like an elephant fighting a mouse or something. The elephant doesn't fight a mouse. You can't drag race. You're going to be shut down. Because I don't accept the evaluations of the world for myself at all, which is the right approach actually. And so you can't race that. And so people, they come up and say, hey, you want to race? And you see that in the world is arrogance says, hey, let me see how I'm doing. Let's see if I can race you. Say, no, don't, you're not racing. I'm not racing anybody. Because they think, it's like Little Deuce Coupe. It's a great Little loose coop with a flathead mill bell. She walketh on a bird like she's standing still. She's ported and relieved and stroked and bored. She'll do 140 in the top end floored. She's my little loose coop. You don't know what I've got. She's my little loose coop. You don't know what I've got. I'm not bragging, buddy, so don't put me down. But I've got the fastest set of wheels in town. If someone comes up, they don't even try. Cause if she had a set of wings, man, I know she could fly. She's my little goose coop. You don't know what I got. Meaning, they'd be driving in Southern California somewhere, and someone would come up, in their whatever they got, their modified super stock something, or their GM, their Chevy or Ford, whatever they got back then, and say, hey, buddy. And the thing is, you don't know with the Deuce Coupes how much it's been modified, how much work they've done on it. So what the Beast Boys are saying is, I'm not bragging, buddy, but don't put me down. I got the fastest seven wheels down. Someone, you know, little, she's my little loose coupe. You don't know what I've got, meaning you don't know how fast I am. You can't tell by looking at the car exactly. You don't know how fast I am. But I'm just telling you, I'm the fastest set of wheels in town. So don't even try, you know. Don't even bother trying, right? So this is the culture, is you're never sure if the deuce coupe, you know, how fast are they really? I don't know. And so you might be surprised. You might be really surprised. And so when you're in the world, you kind of look at everybody and say, ah, they're not so fast. You know, they're not so fast. I think I can drag race them, beat them. But with a Dharma prince, you know, you're not going to. You're going to get shut down. But you're going to be like really mortified. You say, oh my gosh, I had no idea. You know, well, yeah, that's the thing. You don't know. Here in the world, everyone, I seem so lowly in the world that nobody knows, you know, what I got at all. Nobody knows. So I should tell people so they stop trying to drag race me. Because I have to be so polite, not, you know, bend over backwards not to embarrass them. Just say, hey, look, you know, you know, I know this stuff. I'm you know, I've worked at it my whole life, and I got a fast set of wheels, that is for sure. That's true. So you know, so you don't drag race the Dharma prince. This is people have to start getting this into their understanding. You don't say, hey, buddy, you want a race, you know, spiritual race, have a spiritual drag race. You just don't do it. I'd say, no, I don't race. I don't race anyone. Well, what do you mean? You know, you don't think you're any good? I'll let the Dharma King determine how good I am. And that's it. You know, that's just the end of it. So I give advice. I'm saying, do this. If I say do this, then I mean do it. It's good advice. It's really good advice. It means modify your engine. You know, this, look, they said, this is how I modify my engine. I, you know, I'm super fast. Check out this modification. And the car culture, people copy. They say, they'd ask questions. How'd you modify your, you know, deuce coupe? I did this. Oh, wow. And they go do the same thing because they wanted to be faster too. So it's really like that. We got to go faster now. Okay, we have to go really fast. So you really got to hot rod your vehicle. And again, it's pretty interesting. My dad was, you know, at the heart of the hot rod culture back in the late 30s. Maybe early 40s, before Pearl Harbor, for December 7th, was it 1941 or something like that? When he was going to UCLA, hot rod culture at UCLA. And they said, guess what, boys? You know, we need, Uncle Sam needs you. And the next day, down at the recruiting office, signing up. And then next week, North Dakota, basic training, North Dakota. It was the middle of winter, of course, December 7th. So it was the middle of winter, Fargo, North Dakota. And the basic training was so severe, there were a bunch of guys got killed up there from the basic training. And finally, the son of the editor of the Los Angeles Times died there, basic training. They treated him so harshly. It was brutal. There was a sadistic drill, you know, boot camp sergeant was sadistic. Because he thought these college boys didn't know anything about war, and he was going to show them who was boss. And he's killing a bunch of them. And the son of the New York, Los Angeles Times died. And then so they sent reporters there. The owner sent reporters to that place and started reporting on it. He had the juice. And that guy was court-martialed. That sergeant was court-martialed. It was a bad, bad scene. So they were happy to get out of there and fly, start flying to, my dad was pilot flying to cargo planes in the Pacific Islands, landing on the landing strips, the Seabees, built. And then he would bring in the heavy machinery, the jeeps and various other heavy machinery to help build the roads and do more, you know, work on building up the infrastructure of the island. So he would fly over these jungles and drop down on these real short landing strips. It's pretty interesting going from drag racing to landing cars on these quarter miles. Huh? It's pretty ironic because the landing strips weren't more than about a quarter mile. So he had to fly real low over the jungle, real slow, almost crashing in the jungle. And then he cut the engines right at the right moment so the plane would just drop real fast onto the landing strip. Boom, you know. It was just like these, it wasn't an asphalt landing strip. They put these metal kind of like almost like fence wire fencing sort of like stuff, more heavy duty corrugated metal wire fencing, like metal, lay those out in the jungle, and that would give you some traction as you're trying to stop that cargo plane from crashing into the jungle at the other end of the landing strip. And he was like, maybe he's just, you know, young, 21, 22, something like that. Flying, piloting these huge cargo planes. Very, very amazing stuff. So here we are trying to go fast and drop our plane down onto a safe landing strip in this jungle here of arrogance in the world. And here I am still trying to help people go faster, you know, modify their approach, keeping it safe, but also going faster. And we're taking what's called the apex approach. The apex approach is interesting. We're already there. We're already there. And we're just wowing the fact we're already there. We just jumped over everything. We jumped over both jumping and non-jumping. We leaped over, you know, Togol, which is going over the crest, cresting, going over the crest. Well, we're over the crest of going over the crest, which is Longchenpa's apex approach. It's Ramana's, it's Jesus, it's all these. Their approach is to recognize you're already there. And either reality is one, or it doesn't even exist at all, actually. And arrogance says, well, no, it either cannot be changed or it can be changed. And arrogance says that, yes, it can be changed, just really complex and difficult. And that's when we get into what's called concepts. This whole world is just concepts. Everything, this whole, this universe, these worlds, every bodies, they're just mental projections. And it's all conceptual, as Ramana says. The whole body, everything is just concepts. That's it. Nothing more than that. And their concepts are contrast. And their complexity, right? This is how we picture complexity, is through concepts. Thinking, thoughts, or concepts. And in truth, there's no complexity to reality. It's all one. Intrinsic spaciousness is seamless presence in the now. And there isn't any complexity or fragmentation to it whatsoever. Zero. None. And we can feel this. We don't see it set with a sensory perception apparatus. We feel it with spiritual perception. It's more of like a felt sort of thing. There may be some, what we would call visual components to it. Vajrayana Buddhism, Tantric Vajrayana Buddhism gets into these inner visions of all these, you know, golden filaments and all these lights and all these kind of stuff. You know, we don't really get into that at all. You can just bypass all that, actually, because just go to the feeling of intrinsic spaciousness. Just feel it. And this feeling is this brilliant, perfect clarity. So everything feels clear to us. It doesn't matter what our sensory perception is showing us at all, because that's not what's generating the clarity. It's how we, it's this feeling we have that it's all one. And nothing has ever moved an iota out of intrinsic spaciousness. As Rama says, the self is not moving at all, has never moved at all. And so we feel this. And so everything we then are aware of, it feels super clear to us, super present in the moment. Totally here, not in pursuit of anything whatsoever. How could intrinsic spaciousness be in pursuit of anything? How could we say that I'm in pursuit of intrinsic spaciousness? That's a concept. There's nothing about reality to back that up at all. It's a mere concept. So the I is a concept, you know. The ego is just a bundle of concepts we have. Good stuff. Wow. It's going to be bacon next week. The heat is on. The heat is on, and we're about almost, you know, just basically a month away from the 24th of July. Now, why do I say that? Why have I been given this date? I am told by the Holy Spirit, indicated that the Holy Spirit views things from the standpoint of mental agitation, knowing that this causes us so many ills, that this is that there's going to be a tipping point as far as mental agitation in the world on July 24th of this year, 2016. And what happens is once you start tipping, once it tips a certain way, you start building up mental agitation. It starts becoming combustible. I mean, you start feeling, wow, I'm too agitated. What happens when this takes place, mental agitation? There's defense mechanisms against it. One of them is depression. That's what happened to me. I went into depression, what they call. I couldn't sleep, but I became very, very like, I'm bad. I'm the bad one. There's some, you know, it just, I took it on all everything upon myself. The other way is to project it outward and become very aggressive towards others. And this is what I call the yoga girl phenomenon. Yoga girls are getting very aggressive now. They're projecting their own mental agitation onto others. It's really quite astonishing. It's going to catch people by surprise that women are going to become very, very aggressive and demand aggression from men. Demand it. And the men, they're very frightened of this, you know, because the projection of agitation upon them is such that they feel if they don't do what they're told, is they're going to themselves start feeling the mental agitation. They won't be able to sleep. So it's like this plague that is coming. A real plague is coming. So different people handle mental agitation differently. You know, some, you know, drugs, try to drug it, medicate it, sex it out, music it out, try. None of these things work. Okay, none of them work. None of them work. None of them work at all. Take it from me. I know exactly. None of them work. Only turning to the Dharma Kings, to the Holy Spirit, to the grace of God actually works. And only practicing in this full stop on the wow type of showing you have faith and trusting the path that. And when you're willing to wow the grace that arises, because your whole landscape changes of expectations, like I need to do something. Oh, I don't, I'm already got it. You're willing to do that, the grace will arise for you. So you have to trust the spiritual path. It's the only way out of this agitation, actually. And if you don't do this, wars will arise. And what we have now is a massive amount of self-righteousness from political correctness in the world. And this leads to war. It leads to disaster, actually, because these self-righteous, political correct people, minds, have decided to project their agitation out upon others, and they're the bad ones. You know, they're the ones, you know, causing all my agitation. Not my own spirit, not my own arrogance, but it's what they're doing. They refuse to do what I tell them to do. Is basically, you know, political correctness says you got to do this, and we don't realize how hemmed in we are by political correctness. Every day, every talk I have with people, there's always that elephant in the room of political correctness. And when people break through it, they're kind of like, you know, I don't mean to be racist, I don't mean to be this, I don't mean, but you know, don't judge me, please don't tell anybody, you know, but you know, this is what I'm seeing. I'm saying, yeah, common sense. What do you mean? And so many of us can't stand political correctness because we realize it's disastrous. It's a defense mechanism against mental agitation, which is based on arrogance, based on self-righteousness, which Jesus pointed out is the worst development that can take place. This is what he castigated so severely when he was here. The Pharisees and the Sadducees of Judaism, who thought because they did all these various things. I'm busy right now, thanks. Yeah. Who had all these laws and said that if you follow these laws and do these sacrifices and all this kind of stuff, that, you know, you're okay with God. You're fine. You don't have to do anything else. That Jesus said. They were politically correct wankers, to tell you the truth, you know. And I just had somebody come by here, door to door, who's political action, probably a political correct person, you know, who wanted to sign me up. And I said, look, sorry, I can't help you, I'm busy. And he said, okay. Yeah, right? How about that? See how nice that works? I'm busy with the Dharma, spreading the Dharma. And I'm not able to help you with... And by the way, let those who feel they need this world, which is just a device to help them pursue spiritual blindness, let them take care of the world. We don't have to take care of the world for them. I don't need this world. So why should I have to take care of it? It's not my house. Let those who think they own this house and they need it, let them take care of it. Jesus said, let the dead bury the dead. Let the dead bury the dead, right? This is his great advice. So it's not my responsibility. And Rama said, it's not your responsibility to take care of the world. He said, let whoever made the world take care of it. When you repent, it's not your responsibility to take care of this world anymore. This is true. Why should you? You know what? Those who try to make the world a better place is because they know they're coming back here. And they're terrified. So, oh my gosh, I hate this place, but I know I'm coming back. So I got to try to make it better. So when I come back, it'll be better for me. So they're frantically trying to make it better. This is true. But if you know you're not coming back, why are you worried, sweating it? You know, it's their problem. Because this world, the whole purpose of this world is spiritual blindness. That's this whole point. Bodies in the world, all this sensory perception apparatus, is to blind us to spiritual truth. So why should we keep work to make this place attractive? That's bad. You don't see these Dharma kings working to make this world attractive. None of them did. They just said, no, escape this world. It's a cesspool. It's an insane asylum. It's not in my mosque. It's insane asylum. Jesus said, this kingdom is a kingdom of darkness. You know, it's terrible. It's not my kingdom. What are you talking about? He said, no, stay here, Jesus. You got to help us make it really nice. He says, no. I'm going back to my home. This isn't my home. He said, let the dead bury the dead. This is the right approach. So I said, wait a minute. I've slaved my whole life trying to make the world nice. For who? For those who are coming back here. Because they want it. They want to cultivate spiritual blindness, which is arrogance. Let the arrogant take care of the, you know, arrogance. Repentant don't have to take care of arrogance. They're finished with arrogance. They need to focus on where they're going, okay? And realize they're already there. They need to realize they're already there. So these are potent ways to help everyone out here. Let them. I'm echoing what the Dharma kings have said. Let the dead bury the dead. It's not your job to bury the dead. Okay. It's not your job to dress up this world. I mean, I was in a situation where I thought I had to dress it up. Spent my whole life just trying to beautify the world. You know, to please the goddess of arrogance, really. And that's a whole other story. I mean, but basically, you know, our arrogance says, no. We have this authority. It tells us our value comes from making this world a better place. Well, whose authority? Well, I said, well, the goddess, you know, the Virgin Mary or something, which is a misappropriation of the Virgin Mary, who she was probably a Dharma prince herself, but not a Dharma king. She gave no evidence of being a Dharma king. None. These Dharma kings have given vast evidence that they're Dharma kings. Super, super incontrovertible, 100% for sure. Okay. There's no record of the Virgin Mary actually giving this sort of evidence. It's dogma, it's church dogma that they just decided it was the 19th century. Says, hey, you know, this might help us keep the church strong and keep people believing because we're losing a lot of people. And they realized that women were the heart of the church, Catholic Church, for instance, and this is a way of keeping them around, of elevating Virgin Mary to the same status as Jesus, which is ridiculous. Yeah, the Pope has the authority to elevate someone from a Dharma prince into a Dharma king. Are you kidding me? Is the Pope a Dharma king himself? Far from it. Far from it. What Pope has been a Dharma king, actually? What Pope has been a Dharma king? There may have been some Dharma princes, yes. Maybe St. Peter, for instance. But a Dharma king like Jesus? No way. No way. A Dharma king has absolute sovereignty over the entire dream of arrogance and sees through it flawlessly, effortlessly. There's no temptation whatsoever and totally comfortable and established in a profound, profound way, such that any and all means are at their disposal. Such, this is the top of the toppermost. So this is something, a title we give out sparingly, to say the least. There have been some others that have been quite high, like Ramakrishna. I don't say Ramakrishna is a Dharma king. And even Punjaji, I don't say he's a Dharma king. There are plenty of others that have been gurus. Okay, yeah. Neem Karoli Baba, for instance, and Mayor Baba, and you know, you there's a lot you can say, but you know, do I view them as Dharma kings? I don't quite put them, you know, in that toppermost echelon. Where, you know, Sri Sri Anandamayi, you say that, and that says it all. You know, that's a Dharma king. She literally went through every path there was. It only took her like couple moments to traverse an entire path all the way from beginning to the end of salvation. And she went through thousands and thousands and thousands of them just effortlessly like this, 24 hours a day, doing all the gestures, mantras, whatever part was part of it, visualization, whatever. Boom, 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 boom. Just, she said, I'm just putting my kitchen in order. That's all. That's a Dharma king right there. You know, just astonishing. Lila Sadhana and Bhajatpur. Couple of years, she just sat there and meditated. You know, just that's all she did. And what are you doing? She says, I'm going through all the different approaches to enlightenment, just so I'm totally acquainted with them, because she's never been here before. She never has taken the path of arrogance, so she wanted to really be thoroughly acquainted, directly in her own experiencing of all these paths. So when anyone asked her any questions, she knew exactly what their path was and exactly how to advise them perfectly. That's a Dharma king. Okay. It's extraordinary. Very extraordinary. Longchenpa mastered all approaches of Tibetan Buddhism for sure. Had this 360 degree Jangyan Chenpa Kyentse Choki Lodo. Same thing. He could teach all eight vehicles, eight chariots of Tibetan Buddhism approaches flawlessly, as if he was a master of it. He traveled with different hats depending on the ceremonies of the different approaches, and he'd wear this hat, and then he'd go through and do the whole thing for them and empower, do everything. Everyone would say, "Wow, you absolutely know it perfectly. You know, this is a Dharma king sort of thing." Now Ramakrishna, some might elevate him to that. I don't know if they want to. That's, you know, that's their prerogative. He did take different approaches. He experienced various different approaches and said they're all the same sort of thing. Yeah, he might be close to it, but I'm not. You know, I don't myself. It's just I don't quite feel comfortable. I don't have the same faith in him as I would like a Longchenpa, for instance, or Jesus Christ. He was a pretty big in the 19th century. He was quite prominent in spreading the Dharma Vedanta. But the lineage has come from him. There's been sort of some troubles with it in some ways, you might say. It's not quite as stable as I would like to see. Certainly, there are quite a few that fall into that category who are quite helpful and advanced. But, you know, we want to go with the 100%ers, because we're talking about allowing them to evaluate us. Put all our faith in them. You see, as we're coming up upon this agitation in the world, we want to place all our value evaluation in their hands. Say, my value is in your hands. I trust you so much. It's up to you. Longchenpa has shown himself to be so stable of mind, and just, you know, businesslike as businesslike can be. This is someone who's very trustworthy. Who's certainly completely trustworthy. There's no spiritual ego there. Same with Sri Srinandamaya, Ram Harshi, Jesus Christ, Jangan Chenji Toki Lodo. No spiritual ego. I don't have any sense of a spiritual ego there. If someone has a sense of a spiritual ego, there's a problem. That's why I say I'm a Dharma prince. Okay, so don't trust me to evaluate, you know, exactly where you're at, or no, I cannot give you a clear evaluation of where you're at. I can only speak in generalities. You know, I can't know exactly, you know, what everything involved, all your karma, all this kind of stuff. No, I cannot. So in Tibetan Buddhism, they say you have to have a lama. Why? Guru. Why? Because they're doing Vajrayana tantric practices, and you better have an expert guide to that. And so they say you have to completely trust the guru, and they say you got to test out the guru. Sometimes they say at least test the guru for 12 years before you put your life in their hands like that. Because problem with Vajrayana Buddhism is it's a very fast kind of approach that is very problematical if you don't have expert guidance and help at all times. Because you're going to lose your marbles. You're going to become disoriented, very disoriented. The shifts and changes are such. They're aiming for the rainbow body, the body of light, dissolving their body into light. And so they go through these practices of Anuttara, Ati Yoga, Anuttara Yoga, of gathering the energies, inner energies, and the channels and stuff, and moving it about, and somehow, you know, they go through purifying the body to such an extent as far as mental projections go, such that at the time of death they dissolve their body into light. This is their goal, actually. The great transference is light body. The minor ones is rainbow body. That's the lesser one, and there's a minor one that leaves nails and hair. The greater rainbow body is just no body left at all. It turns into rainbow. And the others, the highest one, is just you just turn into a body of light, which is what Jesus did. And some of the early Dzogchen teachers, Garb Dorje, Sri Singha, Manju, the various ones, Yana Sutra or something, there's a number of them, like five of them, Padmasambhava, they turn their body into light, just directly turn their body into light. So in order to have, if you have this as your goal, there's these inner practices you need to do, which you're gonna have to have a guru you trust with your life, and you absolutely trust them, and they're gonna tell you, okay, you feel like you've gone completely insane, that's okay, just wow it, and it'll die down, etc. And so there's all these dangers on this path that they tell you about, really dangerous. They say you're gonna be like a madman, like an eccentric. Your actions will not match your words. You just, people think you're crazy and all this stuff. But don't worry, they always say, this will pass. You know, like that. Well, that's all fine and dandy if you have a great guru who has no spiritual ego, who has done it themselves, but gone through it from their guru, and they can bring you all the way through to completion, okay? But if you don't have that, or let's say the guru has ego, has spiritual ego, then it's a very bad situation. What happens? What happens is, you go get into this and start getting deep into it, and you say I'm in over my head. I am completely in over my head here, and I am lost. I don't know what to do next. And what the ego driven guru would say is, say, don't worry, I have the answers for you. But they'll put it like this. They'll say, well, you haven't gained enough merit, you know, in my eyes, that it's self-released when you are a good enough devotee, quote unquote good enough, and we'll get to that later. Then the answer of how to move through this, your troubles, you're so troubled, your mental agitation, I'll help you out of that severe mental agitation when you show that you're qualified to receive this, the next instructions. Well, what does this do? Well, the person's in mental agitation, they can't sleep, they're desperate. And the guru says they have the answer, but they say, but first you have to do something for me. Well, what does that doing turn out to be? Well, money, sexual favors, is it personal enslavement, doing this, doing that, you know, getting good, making the guru's lifestyle, you know, everything that they want it to be. And they end up getting exploited, you see, because they're desperate. So if the guru knows some of this tantric yoga, they can easily put up a front of making, wowing people with it, really. I mean, they don't have to know that much to wow people. And so they can say, yeah, you do this, and you start seeing the lights, and you do this, and they can act like they know it all. Maybe they've read something like, oh yeah, I know it all, I can help you through, no problem, I've done it all myself, I'm great, I'm awesome. The people trust them, they get in over their heads, they have no idea, they say, my gosh, I'm going crazy. And then they're told, yeah, you're going crazy, but I can easily help you out of that, except you need to, you know, go get some property for me. You know, do you have a house? Okay, deed your house over to me, because we need the income, you know, that empowers my transmission. You know, like, you need to empower my transmission. And they just suck the blood out of all their devotees that way. It's blackmail. This happens. Very bad scene. This is why I say trust the Dharma kings, and the ones we have are very trustworthy, are entirely trustworthy. And they may just, you know, take the apex approach where we don't do any of that Vajrayana yoga practices. I've never done any of those practices because I want to avoid this problem, I'm telling you. I mean, who's qualified? There are a lot of gurus out there claim they're qualified. I very much doubt a lot of their qualifications, actually. Very much so. So Longchampa comes along and says, forget about all that stuff. Just take the apex approach. That's the real approach. No gradualist approach at all. Well, this takes a wow. This is a big wow. You mean I don't have to do this stuff? Yeah. Now, in the back of our minds, we think we have to please the guru somehow. And if we don't please the guru, we're going to be stuck. So if we stop trying to please the guru, we equate that with being stuck. So this prevents us from realizing we're already there. This is what I discovered today. As I said, I've been having so many breakthroughs, it's hard to even keep up with them. But this is like one of the most basic troublesome is that this issue of only the guru can help free me from being stuck. And if I don't please the guru, they won't tell me how to get free of mental agitation. Therefore, if I stop pleasing the guru and say I'm already there, in other words, if I see the guru is also intrinsic spaciousness, the guru too, everything, they're teaching, everything's just intrinsic spacious, that's it. If I see that, then everything's level. And yet the guru wants me to see them as superior to me. They say, oh my gosh, if I see them, everything is equal, they'll stop, they won't give me the transmission I need to get free of mental agitation. So it's like a double bind, isn't it, for us? We're afraid to see everything as equal because of this. But you say, well, wait a minute. If I see everything as equal, where's my mental agitation? What do I need the guru for then? I've never been stuck, actually. If you see you've never been stuck at all, it doesn't matter what kind of inner imagery you have. Or it's the same as external imagery. It's all the same in intrinsic spaciousness. This is what Longchamp is getting at for us. All of them, actually. I'm using Longchenpa as an example because he tends to speak to this from the standpoint, being a Tibetan Buddhist, it's very reassuring to hear what he has to say. Very reassuring because this has caused trouble for us. Some of these you can see why the tantric texts are secret. Samaya is so important because you don't want this stuff getting in the hands of an unscrupulous guru. They will exploit people for sure. For sure. Because these are very, very much techniques that cause this inner landscape to open up and these experiences happening that can just really freak you out. And you have to have expert reassurance on all of this. And if you get someone reading all this stuff, it was secret. You only gave this, the transmission was very secret. Now I understand why. Because some of it's come out, some will come to light. And I get the gist of it. And there are those who got a hold of this stuff and said, hey, you know, I can really wow everybody, you know, by practicing some of this and then telling them, yeah, you do this and you see this light. Oh, yeah, but beyond that, there's another light. And then this happens. You see these citadels of gorgeous light. You know, it goes on and on and on and on and on and on. A lot of these thangkas are actually help depict sort of what your inner imagery and visualizations that will happen to you when you go on this path. And they convince people that they know what they're talking about. And then they get their devotees in over their heads, and then they just start exploiting them. It's like, and it's easy as pie for them, actually. At least starts out that way. Later on, they find out that they themselves are quite trapped. So, we have an aversion to that sort of stuff, way what makes you feel in over your head. You should always wow the grace that's arising for you right now, either accepting or rejecting anything, and not try to force anything or struggle. Don't struggle or try to force, you know, with your breathing, with any particular visual techniques or anything like that. I don't recommend that at this point at all. Because once you get going, the momentum starts happening. You need an absolute expert that's completely dedicated, that promises they'll take you all the way through, and they will not ever abandon you until you're all the way through. That's what you need. Where do you find that right now? No, they'll say, look, my interest in you, I'm disappointed in you, you know, blah, 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 blah. They just kind of let it be known. They have all these spiritual slick ways of saying this, of basically, you need to do more for me before I do any more for you. And too bad you're mentally agitated, but if you just did more for me, you wouldn't be so mentally agitated, you know. It's this thing. It's terrible. And this is sort of, so Samaya secrecy is understandable. But we're not dealing with Samaya type of issues here at all. We're not dealing with any tantric Buddhism here at all. So it's not an issue. Like, we can say, whatever arises, we just wow it. You know, and just realize that too is just intrinsic spaciousness. and take the safe approach, the apex approach. We're already there. Everything's already there. Nothing ever left. There's no leaving. There's no concept. What's a concept? Where's the complexity? Where's the complex? Either the reality is one or it's a complex. It's either one or it's a complex. Where's the complex? What complex does intrinsic spaciousness have? Where's the complex? Or is it not just one vast, smoothed out sameness? The ultimate step in the gradualist path is to realize that all Buddhas and all gurus, they too are this smoothed out sameness. The final step, but we start with the final step. It does just the final step, actually. That's where we start. The apex approach just says, no, everything's just that way already. And then we just wow, say, wow, I can see that. I feel that this is true. And just wow that. Be humble and just wow. And say, wow. This means all of this stuff is not really necessary. No, it's not. I mean, I don't have to really please the guru? No, you don't. There's nothing wrong with helping the guru out. But in terms of, are they superior to me? No, they're not. Nothing is superior. There's no such thing as superiority. Reliability is a different pragmatic question. Are they trustworthy? Yes, they are, because they realize the perfect sameness. Whereas we still, in our arrogance, don't see it. We see a complex. We see it's complex. They see there's no complexity. So temporarily, pragmatically, they're more reliable than we are, but they're not superior. There's no such thing as higher and lower in reality. So we keep looking at this. This is our approach. This is our approach. This is our approach. So even if some of these top gurus, you know, try to drag race you, for me, I just say, no, I'm not dragging race. I don't drag race anybody. You're not evaluating me. The Dharma kings are evaluating me. That's not your job. That's it. End of story. Now, naturally, they'll say, oh, well, you know, when you are having this, you know, all these inner experience stuff, you know, I'm not going to help you then. Well, I'm not going to have all those inner experiences because I'm already on the other side. And if to me, it's just all intrinsic spaciousness anyway, so I'm not after that. You know, take it or leave it, doesn't neither accepting it nor rejecting it. So, but certainly, you'll get some of that. So those who still have, you know, are still driven by arrogance, is you get the feeling like, uh-oh, if I don't accept their evaluation of me, how can they help me through this? We don't, with the Dharma kings, we don't have to accept evaluation from anyone else. You know, let Rama Maharshi evaluate us. We accept his evaluation, for example. And that's it. That's the end of the story. We trust it 100%. That's the end of it. Now, we have these different Dharma kings that help us with this, because the ego-driven spirituality, I call yoga girl spirituality, is, they pressure us. It's pressure. And it's blackmail, essentially. It's extortion. It's extortion. It comes from arrogance. And you get extorted, which is why religion and spirituality has gotten a bad name. Is that a lot of this took place. A lot of it took place. And people said, wow, it's so exploitive. The ego is very exploitive. That's for sure. Now, helping out the Dharma kings is great. Doing whatever we can, whatever needs to be done, we do is fine. Because we know they're going to evaluate us properly. And they're going to bring us home the safe way. And they have no spiritual ego. So our salvation is assured in their hands. So, sure, gratitude, absolutely for that. But we're not going to get in any drag races with anybody here, okay? It's not going to happen. Dharma Prince is like someone capable of being sort of a spokesperson, helping tell everybody, hey, trust in the Dharma Kings, the Dharma Kings. Put your faith there. Let them evaluate you, okay? And this is how you escape the clutches. So give that due consideration for sure. Now, of course, those who would want to exploit you will say, well, we have a super fast way. You know, you do it in a couple months. I hear these things, ridiculous stuff. This teacher's able to give you this, you know, empowerment, and you're liberated, clear light liberation, in a couple months. Some call, say just one day, one week, some maybe they find a couple months, very humble, couple months. But the idea is, it appeals to laziness, does it not? All they're doing is exploiting your laziness. That's it. They know you're lazy. That's your weakness. They point out to you, they know you're lazy, and then they exploit it by saying, no, don't worry. Just do what I tell you to do, and in a couple months you'll be free and finished. And they use that couple months to hook you, and they've got a slave for life. They could just, you know, suck you dry like a vampire. This, got to be aware of this. It takes place. It's very, very prevalent in the world. Always has been, really. Just say thanks, but not right now. Maybe later. I'll have, you know, Sri Sriananda, my mom, evaluate how cool I am. Okay, I'll have her evaluate. I'll have Jesus evaluate how cool I am. Or I'll have Longchenpa evaluate how cool I am. If, you know, from whatever angle they try to get you, you know, you got it covered, really. So all mental agitation is the trouble that's coming. And if you knew how much, what bad trouble that is, you would be very diligent right now. And you would continue to go as fast as you can, but in this wow approach, which allows coasting, and you're in control. Whenever you feel like coasting, you just coast. Don't struggle. That's concepts. Immediately, that's into concepts and complexity. Refuse to go into any complexity. Trust it. You say, no, I saw the truth. There's no complexity to it. It is as it is. If I start putting words and labels to it, it will seem complex, and then I'll start struggling. No struggle. Full stop in the wow. No thoughts, no words, no labels. Trust in your vision that you felt, experienced it the way that it is. You saw it. You experienced it. Yeah. That's it. I see it. Trust it. Trust it. Trust it. Trust it. Trust it. Trust it. So this is just the whole gist of it. And then whatever grace you're ready for will arise for you. Whatever your goal happens to be, if it's rainbow body, light body, you know, whatever, or none of those. Doesn't have to be any of those, actually. Incorruptible body, youthful body, or just like Ramaharshi, you know, who cares about the body? It's nothing. It's not, has nothing to do with me whatsoever. He said that, well, the sensory apparatus has something to do with me. It has nothing. That's just an apparatus we're mentally projecting in order to pursue spiritual blindness. And I say pursue it because we never actually get it. But in the pursuit of it, that itself is the blindness, because we're affirming that there's complexity. If it's all just one, how could we be in pursuit of any pursuit at all? So as soon as we're in pursuit, we have a duality of something and something else that's not, that we need to pursue in order to be whole, right? Be holy. So the apex approach says there's no pursuit. Drop all pursuit. Drop all seeking. Drop all effort. Drop all pursuit. And rest and rest and realize this is all you need to do, is just drop the pursuit of truth, and you will realize all, Truth is everywhere. There's just one truth. It's just all one truth. But you can't experience it as long as you're pursuing it. So that's why Jesus says, you've got to get these holy instants where you, for an instant, you stop pursuing it. And then you get this glimpse and you say, wow. And it could be just as quick as, quicker than a snap of the fingers. You just, it's just a little glimpse. Oh, what was that? Oh, wow. And you realize, I just glimpsed truth. And it's so subtle that you know, we can't pin it down really. And so don't try to force it, make it happen at all. No. Just keep having the will to wow whatever arises. And when you keep practicing that way, it's bound to arise for you. These breakthroughs are bound to arise for you because you have the will to wow it. And that's it. Don't do anything else with it. Mental agitation is the trouble that is coming. It doesn't matter what form is causing it at all. It's the end result's the same. Mentally agitated, you can't stop your thoughts. You can't stop your evaluating. You're over-evaluating everything. It becomes this over-evaluation, and you try to go to bed at night, and your mind is... It's terrible, and you can't stop it. It's horrible. I know. I For like 20 years, 25 years, I couldn't stop it. I started over-evaluating because I got trapped into accepting the valuation of me from the world. The world, you know, instead of from the Dharma Kings, from the Holy Spirit. I knew my worth, my absolute worth from the Holy Spirit. But then when you try to get a relative worth, then your evaluation, you get caught up in evaluating and trying to evaluate others. And your mind can't stop, actually, because out of compassion, you're trying to help, which I had so much compassion to help, but that got twisted around and became hideous because I was caught up in evaluating. And this is what happens. You do too much evaluation. And the apex approach cuts through all evaluation, all of it. We're already there. And there's just the oneness. There's nothing to evaluate, actually. We reinforce this over and over and over and over. So just be quiet. All the great gurus say, just be still. That's enough. Ram Maharshi says, your sole responsibility in this world is just to be still. Just to be quiet. Just to be quiet. That's your sole responsibility here. Talk about getting right to it. Talking with someone today who loves the heat and the light just like I do. It's just great. It's just, there's so much light. A couple days ago, longest day of the year, it's just saturated with light and the heat. Everything is so calm in the dusk, isn't it? As it cools down and just the light is still everywhere, saturated. It's so beautiful. Love the heat. And how it seems to make everything clearer here in some way. It's like nothing can move. You get the feeling that nothing feels like moving. And then you get this feeling, oh, that's like intrinsic spaciousness, is it not? Nothing feels like moving. Just, I can't move. It's so hot. I'm just going to be real still. The trees are real still. I don't want to exert, you know. It's too tiresome. So no pursuit. Pursuit ends. Yeah, everyone feels like, I'm not going to pursue anything. That's great. Like, it's really hot. I wish I was down there in Palm Springs area. It was 122, 3, 4, whatever. Nobody's pursuing anything except AC, I guess. Air conditioning. yeah. It's like, but once I fight it, I'm not moving. I'm not pursuing anything. Thank you very much. And so that's helpful. Temperate climates, everybody's constantly pursuing stuff. It's terrible. Cold climates too, they have to pursue you know, their surplus, building up surpluses constantly. Firewood and various things. Very industrious. Really hot climates, the people are not as industrious. Hopefully there's enough bananas on the trees, you know, just cut cut a bunch of bananas and mangoes and stuff and just eat those. I'll just sit here quietly and just drink some water, lemonade, and not be in high-speed pursuit of anything. This is very helpful. Don't be in pursuit of anything. Drop all pursuit of anything, including enlightenment. Do we need to pursue enlightenment? What is it that needs to pursue enlightenment? What is it? Is it anything at all, or is it a concept that needs that believes in pursuit of enlightenment? Complexity. A complex. That reality is complex. So something has to be pursued in order to be found. There's something missing. The complex needs to be, more than it is or something, right? There's a feeling of a lack that, and something has to be pursued. So we're always pursuing something, whether it's truth, whatever we're pursuing. But we say just drop all pursuit. No pursuit at all. And people basically, okay, great, you're there. So tell me how to, go through this Vajrayana. I said, I didn't do that. I didn't go that way. You don't need to go that way. Oh, yeah, but I have to. Well, they may be stuck. Some guru's got them stuck in that or something. Let the Dharma King straighten it out. This is the problem. Picking up, those who've gone through these problems, and what do you say to them? Because they're still trying to figure it out. Well, where did I go wrong, and all this stuff. Nowhere. Just start wowing the whole situation, and say, wow, I'm finally free of that now. There's something else. I don't have to do it that way, actually. In fact, I've already succeeded entirely. In fact, beyond success, it's. I never needed to succeed. Look, I never needed to succeed at all. All these approaches are because of our arrogance. We think we need to succeed at something, but really, we don't need to succeed at anything. We don't need to succeed at any spiritual path at all. None. It's only when we take it that we need to succeed that the other stuff then arises, and this is how we get to that success. But if we take the point, we don't need to succeed at all. Why do we need to succeed at something? To be what we already are. For everything to be an intrinsic spaciousness. Everything already is there. It never left. Why do we need to succeed at? For that to be the case. Obviously nothing at all. So why do we need to succeed to some spiritual path of all this graduated, effort? And it's all just conceptual, actually. It's still all conceptual. So just be as you are. Realization is not an accomplishment. It's not something that we do. It's not something that's done. Thank you, Ram Maharshi. Realization is not something that's done or accomplished. There's nothing we need to do. We say, well, we need to realize it. No, realization is already there. It's already the case. It's already true. So stop the pursuit of realization. And natural awareness will arise in us. It's already naturally aware of it. Not as an accomplishment, just naturally aware of feeling of intrinsic spaciousness. It's just natural to us. It's just completely natural to us. It's not natural to concepts. How could it be natural to any concept? How could intrinsic spaciousness be felt within any concept? I don't care how spiritual the concept is. How could it possibly be felt? It can't. There's always a feeling that something has to first have to succeed in some way. Something has to happen first. And the idea is nothing has to happen first. There's nothing that can happen to make it so. It already is so. There's no like, it's like we're not spiritual chiropractors here. You don't gotta crack. Oh, now it's an intrinsic spaciousness. Oh, good. No, there's nothing that is. There's no situation like that whatsoever. So again, we just wow this and don't struggle with it. You know, it's like, don't bottle it. Don't try to bottle anything. Clarity was there, just had been expressed. Let the ripples ripple. Don't try to bottle it. We don't even have to bottle truth, do we? So bottle it so it won't escape, you know. There's nowhere for it to escape to. Where can intrinsic clarity, intrinsic spaciousness go? Where can it escape to? Look at it that way. We need to do something to prevent its escape. It's a concept. Doing something is a concept. All doing is just conceptual, including all spiritual paths are simply conceptual. That's the truth. As Buddha said, the wise, the fortunate ones are already on the other side. They realize they're already on the other side. In other words, no concepts. Concepts aren't needed. Nothing needs to happen. Nothing needs to take place. Nothing needs to be pursued, accomplished. So finishing the path, that's a concept. Attaining reality, realization, that's a concept. Drop all concepts, and natural awareness is there of intrinsic clarity, intrinsic spaciousness, intrinsic clarity of clear light vision of intrinsic spaciousness is inherently there. How could it not be there? Where could it go? If there's awareness at all, it has to be of that, right? Of the ground of being. How could we overlook that? That's arrogance to overlook it. The belief that something has to happen, we're making it happen. Then we don't make anything happen as far as being goes. All is created as being. We don't make it being happen through some spiritual practice. So the key is drop all practice. Now, as we say that, the wow arises, so we have to practice the wow. But the more we practice the wow around the issue, drop all practice, the closer we get to actually dropping all practice. Of course, but in doing so, a wow will arise because we shock ourselves. We say, I didn't even know I could do this. That's the answer. Wow. My expectations have suddenly shifted so much. Then, of course, you have to wow it. So you have to have this discipline of the wow. You might say it's the only practice we need to do. Because it's centered on realizing there's nothing we need to do. That's the wow. Walking together in the wow is based on constantly reinforcing the fact we don't need to do anything at all. In fact, any attempt to do anything blinds us to reality. And I mean pursuing conceptually entertaining concepts is an attempt to do something. And it's based on arrogant belief that it's possible to change reality. So of course we think, well, if it's possible, there's a way to do it. And we say that God created us to do this, so we have to do it. So we think we have to have concepts, so we just try to spiritualize our concepts. We try to have spiritual concepts. There's the yoga girl situation of spiritualizing concepts. This is a disaster. Don't let yourself be evaluated by yoga girls, okay? Very important. And this is just a way of saying spiritualizing concepts in arrogance inherently tends to believe that women, the mother that gives birth, knows the answers of how to accomplish the, you know, the impossible, which arrogance sees as just complex difficulty, and that they can guide us to that, you know, and a proper evaluation of us. So who's evaluating us as we grow up? Mother is, right? Our mothers are constantly evaluating us. And a lot of us spend our whole lives being evaluated by our mothers and grandmothers and then, you know, nieces and granddaughters and daughters and such, that they're always evaluating us. They think they know that they're capable of evaluating how we're doing and then giving us advice and how to do better. This is all ego, all arrogance. There's nothing to do. There's nothing to evaluate. And only the Dharma kings really know this, right? And they tell us this. So we, again, do not allow yourself to be evaluated by yoga girls. Let the evaluation in terms of how you're doing towards dropping all effort altogether, all practice, all effort, how you're doing in that regard. Because arrogance will never see it that way. It always sees it as something needs to be done. Always. There's no way around it. There's no way around arrogance. It cannot find a way around itself at all. What it does will try to spiritualize concepts, and that's a deadly trap, as Jesus pointed out. Who crucified Jesus? The ones who were into spiritualizing concepts crucified him. They said, hey, you're going to ruin all our revenue. You know, people are going to realize they don't have to do all the sacrifices and everything. Their whole livelihood and the plush life that their wives had was around all the sacrifice that was taking place and all the money that people paid for these sacrifices. So they were living high on the hog. And Jesus comes along and says, look, you know, let my sacrifice be the final one. And then realize the awful sacrifice is really futile. Put an end to it. And do you think they wanted that? So you think the yoga girls want you to realize you don't need to do anything at all? You don't need any concepts at all? Heck no. They want you serving their comfort, increasing their comfort and security, working for them, for their, you know, to bolster their authority and tell everybody, yes, yeah, spiritualizing concepts, that's the way to go. And they don't want you, you know, to realize you don't need any concepts at all. Arrogance believes that the comfort of the body, creature comfort, serving more greed, get more and more and more is the answer. Right? Is the answer. And arrogance believes a lot of stuff's the answer. None of it is. That arrogance tells us none of it's the answer at all. It just breeds all these problems that we've had throughout history. So just hear this, just hear it, and just wow it. Just wow it, just wow it, just wow it, just wow it. Don't conceptualize it. We don't need any concepts at all. We don't need any complexity at all. There's no complexity to the oneness of intrinsic spaciousness. Zero complexity to it. It's completely self-evident everywhere. It's omnipresence. Completely evident. And we don't see it because we're pursuing a concept of it. So a concept, something must not be it. You know, there's two sides of it. There's not two sides of intrinsic spaciousness. There's not intrinsic spaciousness and its opposite. So what needs to be pursued? What needs to be resolved? Concept brings up a question. What's the question? What can be asked of intrinsic spaciousness in terms of a question? Where are you? Is that really? I'm everywhere. Was that a question? Where are you not? Is that a question? Everywhere. There's no question. It's unquestionable. So what is it that's questioning intrinsic spaciousness? What is, you know, first to say, before someone asks a question, say, wait a minute, before we ask questions, first point out what is it that's questioning intrinsic spaciousness. Let's first establish that. before we start asking anything else of ourselves. Let that be the first question and the last one. What is it that draws into question intrinsic spaciousness? And if there's nothing at all that draws into question, why aren't we experiencing it then as you know, intrinsic, the root quality of everything? We're asking questions of it. What is questioning it? Those stones, they question intrinsic spaciousness? Are they not abiding in their own intrinsic spaciousness right this instant? The bird flying, isn't it not abiding in its own intrinsic spaciousness as it flies? The sky, is what is it that's not abiding in intrinsic spaciousness? Point that out first before any other questions are asked. Because if we're not seeing it, then there must be arrogance. We're intentionally overlooking it. And that's the problem. And overlooking is not calling it into question at all. It's just refusing to acknowledge what's there. So just arrogance, you just have to repent. And just stop refusing to see what's, to feel what's already there. We don't establish it as there. We're not doing this any establishing. We're not supporting it. What do you mean supporting it? What in intrinsic spaciousness is calling out for support? Help, help, help. Ah, it's so heavy. I need help. I need support. What? Point that out first. Before we go down these paths, first point out, where's the necessity for a path, actually? Point that out. So this is what I failed, you know, to bring to light clearly enough when I came into the world. And so I, you know, got bullied into concepts, and then try to straighten all concepts out, and that causes over-evaluating and thinking, you see. So which spiritual concepts are right and which is not, and all this stuff. So this is what the way that the spirituality has been going in the world is going to lead to over-evaluation. The political correct people will project their agitation into control apparatuses, dictatorships, bureaucratic dictatorships. We were joking about that today. They're going to tax you on how many times you go to the bathroom every day. You know, methane tax or something. People are joking about now that they're going to monitor everything. They're going to know exactly how many times you flush the toilet. For sure they will. Easy to do, right? Already monitoring the flow of water in every house. But they will monitor and tax everything. This is just projecting their own agitation and then trying to control it through regulation and laws. And others will go towards, you know, sex, drugs, rock and roll, depression, all this kind of stuff that way. Of trying to clarify the agitation conceptually and then medicating it somehow. Like that, self-medication. So you can see how important it is, this apex, this approach we have, the wow approach. How it can be like a revelation, and you hear this, you say, wow. Where are the thoughts? Where are the concepts? No, I don't need them. They're not, I don't really need to indulge in those. I mean, I can really, wow, really, wow, wow, wow. Calms us down. Doesn't stupefy us. But it keeps us from over-evaluating. And I've highly advised everyone to stop paying attention to the news. I spoke with somebody recently. I'm just meeting these people, and I told them I boycott them. He says, so do I. I don't pay any attention to it whatsoever. He says, and I said, they're trying to stupefy us. And he says, yeah, I know. That's exactly what they're trying to do. So there's people who are aware of this. And so people are boycotting the news. They are aware it's an intent to stupefy us so we can be easily controlled conceptually, trivialize everything so we don't see the big picture, make us very concretized, and so we don't go to abstract oneness, don't see that this, either it's all oneness or there's complexity. There's no complexity. So we're able to see there's zero complexity. That's abstraction. Not even any complexity to intrinsic spaciousness. Point out the complexity to intrinsic spaciousness to anyone. Point it out. Isn't everything just effortlessly in intrinsic spaciousness? Without any effort on its part at all? Where else could it be? Where else could it be? So being is effortless, actually. There's only being, and it's all effortless being. Don't conceptualize that. Feel it. Just allow the feeling, just the wow first, and then the more you refuse to conceptualize, the more closer you get to feeling it. This is called Journey Beyond Words, which is Jesus' book, Journey Beyond Words, transcribed by Dr. Brent Haskell. And it's a journey beyond words to feeling it. But this is like a stable feeling. It's bliss. It's a bliss feeling. Now, as soon as we say, how did I get there? That's a concept. You see, this is the land of no concepts, including how did I get there? There's no I, there's no concept that got anywhere. Concept is just a belief in complexity, which is denial of impossibility. The impossibility of changing reality is simply denial of that. Where else can you go? Except, well, it must be complex and difficult because we can't see any way to do it. We say, wow, you know, how do we get rid of intrinsic spacious? Well, it must be, well, if we deny it's impossible, then we must say, well, there must be a way, but we, you know, it must be real difficult, real super complex difficult. And then this seems to buy us what? Time, space, process, and form. It buys us a dream. That's how we buy the dream. What else can we do? Either it's impossible, we recognize it's impossible, or we believe it's possible. And yet it seems, if we believe it's possible, then the feeling of impossibility that we have, we have to project that into a vast dream of complexity and time and space, process and form. So it seems like it's going to take, you know, billions and billions of years of incredible complexity and evolution in order to, you know, achieve this outcome. We just have to project this dream of vast complexity. The Big Bang is a mental projection, is all it is. It all comes from not accepting that it's impossible. The feeling that I feel is impossible. Like, how come it's ridiculous? Then there's no necessity to project at all, actually. Right? We don't need to project a notion of concepts and complexity, difficulty, time, space, process, and form, gradualism, evolution, all these dynamics of nature and body sensory perception apparatuses that are blind, apparently blind to intrinsic spaciousness, just reactions. We don't need to project any of that. Never did need to. No need to it whatsoever. Final projection, just a projection of intrinsic spaciousness, you might say. The final illusion that removes all illusion, final perception that frees us from all perception. That is very simple. We don't struggle with that. We just, no concepts, no labels. Hard to have concepts if there are no labels, right? No evaluating. No advancing, retreating, accepting, you know, declining. No doing of anything. 360-degree wow. Just sitting here in the wow. Very, very smooth, fast path. Very safe path. All you get here is you feel some fatigue, some stress and fatigue. Sure. From shifting the landscapes, our expectations keep shifting. And we say, wow, this really does work. I thought I'd have to, wow. I mean, so I don't have to worry about pleasing a guru. Oh, wow, you know, how completely changes all my expectations of everything. My whole structure is designed to please. I realize my entire structure, personality, is to try to please those who I think know the way and are correctly evaluating me, when in fact they don't. They never did. They never did. They're just using me to try and clean up the trash from the world. Clean up trash. I mean, what do people want in this world? They want a world that looks like spotless and beautiful to them, so they feel comfortable. They say, oh, I can, yeah, this is my home. I feel comfortable here, you know, in this absurd projection of spiritual blindness. They feel, I want to feel comfortable. That's the problem. I just felt it was just more beautiful. Oh, there's a piece of trash over there. How terrible. You know, we used to be that way here, United States, California. You know, no trash anywhere. Nobody was like, I was taught, don't ever leave any trash anywhere. This is like one of the worst sins you could possibly commit. So my whole life, I've hardly ever had a single piece of trash anywhere. I'm super conscientious about it. I feel like it's something terrible happened if I do. You know, that's how. But I'm driving on the freeways, it just litter trash everywhere because, you know, you get people come in different values. For them, that's not their goal. They don't care if it's litter everywhere. They're just trying to survive. What the heck? Who cares if some. So trash is blowing out of trucks and out of everything, and just there's so much trash. I can't believe it. Where does all this trash come from? It's unbelievable. You go to these countries and you see the whole country's just littered with trash. They throw tires on the side of the road. Whatever they have, they used to throw it on the side of the road. That's it. It's like, wow. So there's a big change here. Big change. And so the idea is what I'm supposed to pick up everybody else's trash to try to make the world look better. This is what the goddess wants. This is what the goddess of arrogance wants. Tells us, oh, no, we gotta, you got, you know, it's a long haul here. You better make it nice. You know, make the journey nice. It's a long, slow evolution. It's really difficult, really complex. You know, you've got to make everyone feel cheerful and happy along the way. So let's make sure we, you know, keep hauling out the trash. I mean, everybody keeps producing so much trash, do they not? Sorry, I'm an errand boy, you know. Just, hey, here, boy, here's some money. Go deal with my, get me some stuff. Get rid of the trash. Do this. And I'm thinking, well, I need to do that because, you know, maybe the goddess knows the way. You know, I have to know some secrets or something. No, there's no secrets that need to be known at all. We don't need any concepts, not even of success. We don't need any concepts of some secret way or anything. Those are all concepts. There's nothing we're lacking. There's nothing our natural being is lacking at all. Nothing is lacking in intrinsic spaciousness, even in the slightest bit. So we just get conned into serving like slaves the beautification of this planet. That's not our responsibility at all. Let those who think this is their home work on beautifying it. This is not our home. Concepts are not our home. Let those who believe in arrogance, let them take care of arrogance. Okay, we've been cruising through this stuff, just cruising along. It is warm. It is warm here. Very, very still. Not a ripple of breeze even. I knew someone went down to LA this week. Said it's cooking down there, just cooking. Yeah, it's a zoo down there. They said this is a zoo, maybe even worse up here. That's what people are telling me now. They say, yeah, LA is a total zoo. As always, but it's up here. My gosh, it may be just as bad or worse now, San Francisco Bay Area. It's an ego-driven place, this area. That's why everybody has Teslas, because they're the fastest set of wheels in town. Nobody can beat them at a drag race because it's 100% power directly to the drive, you know, the drive chain. I mean, to the wheels. I mean, really, the differential of the gears, it goes straight right into, there's no RPM at all. you don't have to build up RPM or compression or nothing. It's just straight drive. So and no gears. There's no gearing, right? And it's just direct electrical turning of the wheels. This little dynamo they have back there, whatever it is, it just goes direct from the battery straight into the coils, and it just that turns the wheels. So you can't beat them in a drag race. They're so fast. There's governors on them, secret computer governors. And someone told me that if you request and have the right pull and influence, etc., they can unlock the governor on it, and they call it ludicrous mode. And the car's even faster. It's ridiculous, ludicrously fast. It's actually slowed down a little bit by the computer system. Dangerous, though. I mean, there's no gears. I've seen someone blew my doors off on a Tesla. They just decided they're just going to floor it, and I was shocked me how fast they closed them. I was looking in the rearview mirror to get over to the next lane on the freeway, and I saw this car coming. I said, "Gee, they seem to be coming awfully fast. That's weird." It was a Tesla, and they just went whoosh. And I said, "What? I'd never seen such acceleration." So I was just thinking it's a normal car, but they go faster. And people up here, you know, just everybody, use anybody drives a Tesla up here, so they can feel they got the fastest set of wheels in town. From a materialistic standpoint, they're following, you know, concepts and arrogance and telling us, you know, judging and say, we know how to evaluate you. Don't worry, we'll put all the soft evaluation software in place around the world, and you'll be correctly evaluated. So, is this what we want? We want to be evaluated by the Tesla people, and they know how to evaluate us? Really? They're Dharma kings? Where's the evidence? Fact is, there's zero evidence. Jesus, massive evidence. Okay. Tesla folks, yoga girls, etc., zero evidence. So we're supposed to accept zero evidence? That sounds like arrogance. It's like, we'll just arrogate that there's evidence. Even though there's zero, we'll say that zero evidence is the new 100% evidence. And we'll just define it conceptually that way, and we say, okay, that it's good. Call it good. And now we'll use that to evaluate. So we're going to let them evaluate us, which is what's coming. They preemptively, these people believe that their role is to evaluate the whole world, all of us, that they're smarter than us, they know how to evaluate us. And yet there's zero evidence that they're Dharma kings. Which means there's zero evidence that they know that absolutely nothing needs to be done. There's no evaluation needs to take place at all. And the Dharma kings can see how close you are to getting to realizing no evaluation, no judgment. As Jesus said, the final judgment is your own realization. There's nothing to judge. He said the final judgment is not God's final judgment, but Christianity has that all wrong. It's your own judgment where you realize, your mind realizes that there's nothing to judge at all. That's the final judgment. Of course, when you see there's nothing to judge, it's the end of judgment. So that's why it's called the final judgment. And people have gotten trapped by these gurus. It's their own fault because they're looking for someone who's a failure and who can't lead them to liberation. And they claim, see, trappedness is the highest. The teacher's the highest teacher ever, and yet they can't bring anybody to true enlightenment. They say, you see? Arrogance says, you see? What the Dharma kings are saying are not true. You can't ultimately be liberated. It's not possible. That they're trying to empower that notion by their own folly, you know? Really, that's what's happening. So repent. The answer, you say, I'm stuck. No, just repent, and you realize you're not stuck at all. It's a gambit. You know, you're using, I'm stuck. It's just a ploy to hook others. Just an arrogant ploy. It's really to enslave others. Nobody's stuck. How can we be stuck? We're stuck outside intrinsic spaciousness? Point out what is stuck outside intrinsic spaciousness. Only concepts could possibly give the impression of such a ridiculous notion. But are we stuck in concepts? Concepts too are in intrinsic spaciousness. So how are we stuck? What's stuck? What is stuck outside of intrinsic spaciousness? What is stuck there? There's nothing outside of it. So how can anything be stuck? Stuck. I don't know. They say tomorrow will be a lot cooler. you never know what the ocean's going to do as fog goes, but there's a hot one. I mean, how? Let me ask you a question. There's a funny thing about technology here. We have all this monitoring, super duper. We'll measure every raindrop. And how could the weather service get the forecast wrong by 10 degrees? And they did. They said 88. I checked it this morning, last night, this morning, 88. Okay, it was 98. How could they make such an incredible blunder, 10-degree blunder like that in today's modern age? This is ridiculous. It's a difference between a nice, warm day and a scorching day. I mean, 88, 98 is a huge difference in terms of your activity level. Like 88, you take a walk in the hills and you sweat. Somebody, it's nice, I can handle it. But 98, you're going to overheat. So making a mistake like that is a drastic mistake, because you're talking about overheating. If you can't predict a super hot day like this, you're making the worst mistake there is in meteorologically. Because people rely on deciding what they're going to do. Let's say you decide to go play golf today. It says 88, wonderful. Well, you're out there and it's 98 and you're not ready for it, not prepared for it. You get an older person, they're going to get heat exhaustion. I got heat exhaustion one time, real bad. It took me months to recover, maybe 6 months. It was terrible. After that, every time I saw the sun, the sun seemed to be hitting me with bruising rays. It's like, like it struck me that I was being bruised and hurt by it. It was horrible. I loved the sun. I couldn't believe it, but it was true that when you get heat exhaustion, you have this aversion to sunlight. It shocks your nerves. It's amazing. Ultimately, it finally went away, but I still have a little bit of like trepidation about that. I don't want to experience that heat exhaustion again. That was really weird. Your body doesn't seem to recover well from it. It's kind of a shock. So making an error in forecasting like that is a drastic error they made. Unforgivably drastic error. You got to be kidding me. In today's age where everybody's bragging about their accuracy, they can't get it. They can't, 10 degrees? It's not like they couldn't see it coming. I mean, what were they thinking? I guess they thought the fog would come in or something. And granted, here it's a little tough because of the fog. But they've been dealing with fog forecasts forever here. And you'd think that they would have a pretty good handle on it, but apparently not. At least could have given some margin. Instead of surely saying 88, they could instead say, well, if the fog comes in, it's going to be 88, but if it doesn't, it could hit 98. So they should give a variable range here in the Bay Area. Actually, it could be anywhere from 98 to 88, depending on what the fog does. Instead of saying, with this overconfidence, we know it's 88. They're overconfident. They don't want to admit, maybe there's some variables there with technology. They can't pin it down yet, but they say, no. We can pin everything down. Really? They can't even evaluate being at all. If you can't evaluate being, they try to overcompensate by saying, I can evaluate all this other stuff. But isn't that all this other stuff just a mental projection for the purpose of claiming we can evaluate it? What came first? All this, or our desire to evaluate? Is this not a projection of our desire to evaluate? Buddha said the problem, root to the problem is desire, right? Doesn't it come first, our desire to evaluate? Our desire for complexity, and then the complexity arises? Isn't that how it actually takes place? Since it's a mental projection, what's causing the mental projection? We're told desire, which is really arrogance, actually. Better word for desire is actually arrogance. Spiritual pride, what Christianity calls it. Jesus and the Horse of Miracles would call it arrogance. I like the term arrogance, because it's arrogating, trying to arrogate a false will to God. But guess what, God? Your will is that reality, that we have that you create us with the power to change reality. That's your will. So guess what? We can do it. And you can't stop us. Ha ha ha. That's arrogance. Very good drink. Mango lemonade, Hubert's mango lemonade. It's just, but then of course, you know, anything like the sweet or whatever, it leaves an aftertaste, right? Water's actually better. My singing voice is lousy right now. It was lousy today, terrible. I can't go high anymore. I don't know. We'll just see how it goes. I just worked on harmony. All sorts of lower harmonies, trying to work on that. It's very difficult to do the bass harmonies. I'm not good at that at this point. Workout, I'm hitting it hard. Saturday, I did massive lower body leg workout on all this hopping and skipping and jumping and running sideways. Okay, those are like football drills, aside, you know, going sideways and high-stepping and going on tiptoes, tiptoeing a whole circuit and just on your tiptoes, a little tip, 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 high-stepping, your knees real high like that, side-to-side skipping. All I did many circuits of all these different, of course, none of them jogging, no walking, no jogging. This should be your mantra, no jogging, no walking. If you really want to get after it, skip. And all the variations of skipping. I did long skipping, short skipping. Long skipping is you try to leap with each skip as far as possible. You can easily do this. All right, find a little circuit somewhere around your place, around, you know, wherever you are. Just try that. You go to a track, don't walk or jog around a track. Skip around it. I know nobody else is doing it, so what? You're not using their evaluations of you anymore. If you're running, high step it. Get the knees as high as possible. And like you're on your toes. Prancing. Prance around the track like that. Prance around. That's a real workout. And then yesterday, upper body. And then today, some. Oh, no. That was 2 days ago. That was Saturday. And then Saturday, lower body. Sunday, heavy on the upper body. Then Monday, I hit the lower body again really hard, stairs, two at a time. Whew. That's a crusher. We're used to going one stair at a time, right? Try going, you know, massive number of stairs. Just try going running a stadium. Go to stadium and do two stairs at a time. Always at least two stairs at a time. So you're really stretching it. Every step you're going up to. That you really feel it. It is just a super powerful workout. So I was really tired yesterday. And today too. Oh boy. The body feels, you know, drained and tired. Doing doubles, I call it. Doing doubles. The next step, run doubles. Try running doubles. I've run singles, but try running doubles. I haven't tried running doubles yet. That's what the guys are working out really well. They run doubles. That's what they do. That's the toughest workout is to run doubles. The guy, like I said, the guy's a great work. It's a good workout. And I said, no, it's a great workout. I said, yeah, you're right. It's a great workout. Yeah, I do, you know, jump rope. I'm doing, you know, upper. So I'm just hitting the workout really hard still. Just, you know, still pushing it hard. Body feels tired, kind of weak from it, you know. And weight's up a little bit because I'm working out. You want to carry a little bit of weight there. You don't want to try and, you know, slim down too much when you're really working out hard. That it can make you feel too exhausted. There's a little, you know, the heat. You want to have some weight there. So I went up. I'm eating a little bit more right now. And but, you know, still pushing everything full blast. Golf swing, ridiculous. It's getting better and better. But I don't even try to do much anymore because I realize I'm on the right track. So why even bother swinging the golf club? It's not even needed anymore. I know the exercises that they're working. So just keep doing the exercises. That's all. If you know it's working, why, you know, if something's healing, don't pick at the scab. Let it heal. Let it heal. At some point, you know, if I ever get on a golf course again, I don't know if I will or not. The swing will be there. The power will be there. And if I don't, I'm getting in great shape. So it's all good. It's all good. I don't need to go out on a course and evaluate it. Because I know what I'm doing is working. I just swing the club a couple times. I say, whoa, you know, wow. It's ridiculously better than it used to be. So just keep doing it. Keep working out. Same thing with the spiritual path. You get glimpses and breakthroughs. You just say, wow, it's working. Just keep doing it. Trust it. Trust it. Trust it. Trust it. Trust it. Trust it. That full stop on the wow is the perennial wisdom of the path. Okay. Perennial wisdom of no path, actually. The path of no path. The practice of dropping practice. It's the key to it. We have to keep practicing no concepts, no action, no doing, just sitting quietly. Punjaji said, they asked him, what's the quickest way? He said, just sit here, just sit quietly. That's the quickest way. That's true. It's absolutely true. How many of us will do that? Well, we better do it. And here's another I want to emphasize again. Don't be ashamed to be desperate. Desperation is the greatest wisdom here in this world. Your house is burning down. Mental agitation is coming after you, big time. And you do not want to get stuck in that mental agitation. So it's the worst. Can't stop your mind. You think the mind's, you can't control it anymore. Over-evaluating, and it gets caught up in its own evaluating and can't find any way to stop. This is what happens. And those who've gone through this know exactly what we're talking about here and how terrible it is, how scary it is, actually. Most of them take medications for it. I didn't really, well, I did some. Didn't help. Nothing helped. The psychiatrist said, finally said, there's nothing we can do for you. Nothing medicine or psychiatry or anything can do for you. Gave up on me. And that's, you know, had a course in miracles. I said, okay, let's see what Jesus can do for me. And the rest is history. Let's see what a Dharma king can do, right? Let's give them a chance. Because the other stuff, it doesn't really work. It can, it's like a wheelchair, you know, like a cripple. And in a wheelchair, basically. But if you really want to be compassionate and help others, you're not going to settle for that. You're going to say, hey, you know, this is not the answer I really want at all. So I'm going to have to tough it out and you know, get to what I really want. Okay. We're getting pretty close to... How we doing? We have a little time to go here. Little ways to go. Just cooling out here on this blistering day. Wherever you are, I don't know. It may be blistering as well. But this summer here, United States has started out. Just boom. First day of summer. Boom. People got to be thinking, say, holy cow. It's could be a record setting summer possible, right? If heat could be scorching, and this is a problem too. People get agitated, they can't sleep, it's too hot, it compounds. So there's this compoundment issue coming this summer. What I've been warned about is a compounding taking place. We've got politics going to reach a boiling point. That can very much agitate people. And again, many people don't even realize that they're agitated because they project it. But they become feisty towards others and very controlling and domineering and demanding and all this kind of stuff in the wrong way. Not in a truly compassionate, wise, clear way of, like I say, practice, 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 practice. This is the right use of being adamant. But they say, do what I tell you, as far as, control, 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 control. Get out of my way, get out of my way, get out of my way. I almost got hit by a yoga girl yesterday, backing up. Just get out of my way. They couldn't wait for me to get, I was trying to get out of their way, they couldn't wait. I'm not going to wait for you to get them out of the way. So they were going to smash, in my vehicle. It was amazing. I said, what in the heck is going on here? Give me 1 second. I'll get out of your way. They wouldn't give me even 1 second. This is called mental agitation. They're under the spell of mental agitation. They expect everybody to get out of their way. And, hell hath no fury like a yoga girl scorned. Well, hell hath no fury like a yoga girl with mental agitation. And get out of her way, or else, the claws come out. And it's scary. Because the legal system is all set up to do whatever they tell them to do. It's their toy now. They've made it that way. Mental projection, agitation has changed the legal system away from a Judeo-Christian legal system, which tried to be just, to simply a tool of agitation, tool of political correctness. 1 second here. Tool of. Okay, thank you. Okay, yeah. So it's just turned it into a tool of mental agitation here. I get all these da 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 da. What is this? No. A stupid phone, sorry. Oh, yeah, okay. Well, what do you expect? Yoga girl, the demands are hitting me. And I want you to do this right now. You'll feel it, right? Aren't you feeling it right now? I want you to do this right now, this instant. No, 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 no. I want you. I'm controlling you. You have to do this right now for me, right now. Can you give me an instant? No, no, no. Right now. You have to do this for me. Yeah. You feeling this in your life? Well, you will be. You will be. You will be. I'm feeling it all the time. I say, hey, wait. Give me like 1 second. What's going on? This is agitation that's building up in their mind. And the way they deal with it is demand that you do exactly what they tell you to do this instant so they don't get aggravated. You see what I'm saying? They think their aggravation is coming because you're not doing what they're complying with their demands quick enough. So their whole thing is going to be you need to comply instantly with their demands. And so you don't have any time to say, no, wait a minute. Holy Spirit, Dharma, King, they won't give you an instant to even consider. Like, is this the right thing to do? No, they say, no, don't even think about it. Just do what I tell you to do because I know what's best for you. I'm the evaluator of you, of your life. This is the problem we've got into with this radical feminism. It was just turning back to the mother, the feminine, as the arbitrator, the evaluator of her life, instead of the Holy Spirit. Christianity says the Holy Spirit's your evaluator of your life and nothing else. And this is the correct perspective. And this has been sabotaged. Yeah, by materialism, and the agitation that comes with materialism has changed the legal system, has changed culture, has made it such that it feels like we have to comply with the yoga girl, big mother bureaucracy without any of our own evaluation of saying, no, wait a minute, who do I want to evaluate me? You or the Dharma Kings or the Holy Spirit, let's say. You the Holy Spirit. They say, no, you can't even, no, you just have to do what we tell you to. We're your evaluator. So he said, no, the Holy Spirit's my evaluator. So I've already run into this. It's just ferocious demands from the yogis that you do what I tell you to do and do it instantly. I don't want any back talker of me and say, hey, you're not my evaluator. The Holy Spirit's my evaluator. You don't know anything about what's right for me to do. You don't know what's cool for me to do. at all. And then they run the whole sex scam on you, saying, oh, well, you know, if you do what I tell you to do, I evaluate you the right way. Oh, gee, let's have sex if you do it. You know, you get rewarded for that, you know, kind of thing. That whole scam. What a scam that is. As if somehow that you know, that you're allowing them to be your evaluator because they're treating you like a dog. I saw someone give the dog some treats in the store. Here, dog, here's some treats, you know. They think they control you with like giving treats to a dog, and then you'll turn your evaluation over to them, and then they'll end up demanding that you comply instantly with everything they say. They'll start ramming people, their cars. They're almost to that point here. It's just, get out of my way. What are you doing in my way? I feel so strong. Like, what are you doing on my road? Get out of my way. You shouldn't be here at all. I'm being inconvenienced. This is why I'm agitated. If you didn't inconvenience me, I wouldn't be agitated. No. Sensory perception is agitating them. Pursuit is agitating them. Arrogance is agitating them. Their own arrogance is what's agitating them. Plain and simple. Their own arrogance is what is agitating them, plain and simple. So I'm under a lot of pressure right now to comply instantly. And you know what? I'm still taping, am I not? So I'm going to face the wrath of not giving instant compliance. My whole life I've been this way, facing the wrath, you know, of Big Mother, of not complying instantly with what they tell me to do, and they just constantly hate it. It's never fast enough. It's never good enough, is it? No. No matter what you do, they say, well, I'm still agitated. That means you didn't do it right. This is what we're running into now in our business and work. It's the yoga girls say, well, I'm still agitated by what you did. Therefore, it's not my arrogance that's the problem. It's you didn't do it right. And this is a truism in their minds, a truism. It has to be that you didn't do it right. This is what we're going to run into, smack dab into that, along with a lot of other stuff. But this is very potent problem, because we tend to cave under that situation. We've been trained to be like dogs. That's why they're training us all to be like dogs. I have a treat for you, as long as you accept me as your evaluator, which means then you have to do exactly what I say. My evaluation of you is you're causing my agitation, not my arrogance. I'm naive. I'm innocent of all arrogance. Your arrogance is causing me problems. You're inconveniencing me. You must remove that inconvenience immediately. And of course, it doesn't work, so they just put more demands on you. That doesn't work, they put more demands on you. You're still not doing it right. And in fact, you can never do it right. You can never win. You can't win. You put in a can't win situation there, because they're refusing to repent. They're projecting their arrogance upon you, and you're the problem. Remember, we're all sinners. The very fact we believe we're a body in a world, sensory perception, all means we're sinners, complete arrogance. Only arrogance could possibly project this dream. This is a dream of arrogance. Mental projection is arrogance. Except for the Holy Spirit's remedy. But mental perception is arrogance. And mental projection and perception is arrogance, really. And there's no way around this. You have to repent. So they're not repenting. They say, no. We'll be happy as long as you stop agitating us. Get out of my way. Do this for me. Do this for me. Do this, honeydew thing, this. Oh, is it ever enough? You ever heard anyone do enough? No, it's never enough. They're still even more agitated because it doesn't work. And they say, well, I got a defective dog here then. You know, they're not making me happy. And they say, we're above criticism. Really? They're above repentance? So what they're really saying is nobody could claim that we're arrogant, because our whole thing is saying that you're arrogant and we're not. That's dualism. Can anyone, as Jesus said, anyone who even remotely thinks they're a body is arrogant. That's all there is to it. The mind is very sick indeed. Oh, it's sick, but they're not really sick. It's arrogant. The mind can't really be sick at all. Nobody's stupid. Everyone's brilliant. They're brilliantly deceiving. We're brilliantly deceiving ourselves. There's nobody who's stupid. Stupidity doesn't exist, actually. It's all brilliance. We're all completely brilliant, but we're trying to use our brilliance to change reality. And then that leads to all these crazy troubles we have. An mental agitation. Even the stupidest person you think you've ever seen, they're brilliant in their stupidity. It's a pretense. They're pretending this. They've come up, they think this is going to work. But they're still brilliant. So I'm just, standing up to the pressure I'm under right now. This very moment is a perfect example. I'm saying no. I'm my duty is to the audience here, those, the devotees in the court, in the court of the Dharma Kings. That's my loyalty, because they're the ones choosing to be evaluated properly. That's my responsibility, is to promote proper evaluation, which lessens in mental agitation. So I'm listening to those who repent. Now I'm getting more pressure.
Yeah. Of course. Just wait a few minutes, okay? I'll be right there.
There's the pressure. Perfect, perfect. Are you gonna do this? Are you gonna do this? I said, yeah, just wait a few minutes. That's what I said. Just wait a few minutes. Well, that didn't get a very good response. Perfect example, huh? We're all under this god-awful pressure right now, and they refuse to acknowledge it. They say, no, guys, you're the bad, you're the egotist. We don't have any ego problem at all. You're the problem. This is feminism. Feminism is rooted in the belief that all ego problems reside in men and none in women whatsoever. That women can do no wrong. This is their whole philosophy, which is philosophy, what? Arrogance. Totally arrogant. That somehow arrogance can decide who's arrogant and who isn't? That arrogance decides who's arrogant? No, let the Dharma Kings decide who's arrogant and who's not. Because they're the only ones who can properly evaluate this, right? They're the only ones who can evaluate this, because there's no arrogance in them whatsoever. So how can we let the feminists decide who's arrogant and who's not? This is ridiculous. And yet they've changed the legal system to accept this. Yeah, so.